next scientist was recognized for contributions ranging from the study of scaling violations in deep inelastic processes to the use of supersymmetry, multifractals, and growth models in statistical physics. And, in particular, his groundbreaking analysis of the replica method in complex systems. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome the 1999 Dirac medalist, Giorgio Parisi. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and I also for being here because and also for organizing this anniversary section ICTP, because I believe that ICTP is playing a very important role in the scientific community and also in the general problem of developing technology for the world. Now, what I would like to speak today is to give some ideas, because this is a quite a big subject, and of what happens in equilibrium dynamics, which is for systems which are nearly at equilibrium. It means systems which decay very slow toward equilibrium, and where the equilibration time are very, very large. So what I will essentially will certainly do, I will discuss just a few points. I will present a mini introduction to structural glasses. I will discuss edging in glasses. I will discuss the replica potential as some tool. And I will also discuss the fluctuation-dissipation relations. And some generalization fluctuation dissipation relation. Now, I will first all, there's some distinction between spin glasses and structural glasses. In structural glasses, you are more or less accustomed as the window glasses, but a lot of other material, like a glycerol and so on. Spin glasses are some more exoteric material, are some system which have both ferromagnetic and anti-ferromagnetic interaction. Therefore, there are some, and the ferromagnetic and the ferromagnetic interaction depends on how the atoms are in the material, and just because these alloys, the atoms are random, and therefore they contain some kind of quenched noise. So therefore, while in glasses, the randomness is not in the Hamiltonian, it's just in the way that the atom goes on. If you consider the distribution, if you just consider the spins in spin glasses, what happens is just in the formation of the alloy, there has been a certain noise, a certain randomness, and therefore they sequentially disordered. This distinction is important at a certain stage and another stage, and also this, the fact that the Hamiltonian is reality different means that the two systems at the end will belong to different universality classes, and the detailed behavior will be different in the two cases. Now, let me just, the typical thing that you can measure in viscosity, that you can measure in glasses is viscosity. Now, I mean, everyone that have been to Venice have seen people that are working to construct glasses, and glassware, and you see glasses, you see that at certain moments they are very they are liquid. When they cool, the viscosity increases. You can still manage to deform the glasses. Of course, if you try to deform a glass at room temperature, you will break and nothing will happen. Now, the typical behavior of the viscosity, this is just, okay, this is just a cartoon of what happens to the viscosity. You have just, we start from something which is order the liquid, it will increase, and then, okay, and there are some kind, and a certain moment, there is some region which maybe have something like a power type behavior increase, and at a certain moment, it will increase maybe faster. But, let me just, this is just some kind of discussions, but let me look to real glasses. Now, suppose that the viscosity, I mean, the viscosity is essentially proportional to a time, because it's essentially the time that the atoms take to diffuse. Now, just if you just take a liquid, the microscopic time is order 10 to minus 12, because it's the time of collisions between atoms. And if you go to, or maybe 10 to minus 14, or if you go to standard time, which you can do experiment, which is 1 hour, this means that you, which is 10 to the 4 second, this means that you can measure a time which goes from the microscopic scale to the macroscopic scale of 1 hour, which means all the order 10 to the 10 order magnitude is a region where you can measure the time. And indeed, if you look to the viscosity experimentally, it increases essentially, well, no, this is 10 to the 16 order magnitude. Of course, when the viscosity is so big, it means that in order to be measured, you have not to wait 1 hour. But if you would increase the experiment, this measurement here of large, apart from technical difficulty, you'd need a time measurement which is not on the hour scale, but on the year scale. And of course, this is not so easy to be done in a controlled way. So typically, typically happens that when people when say that when the relaxation time is over 1 hour, or the viscosity is 10 to the 14 in some unit, you say that this is a glass transition, because the system is nearly solid for all nearly practical purpose. So once that you have defined the glass transition, you put here that the glass transition temperature divide one of the temperatures. This is essentially bit, if you want, a unit of this glass transition. Let me stress that the glass transition is just from human scale. If you would say in another planet where people will live much longer or much shorter, they will change the definition of glass transition. Now there are some material with like silica and some window glasses which have some dull, I would say, not so much interesting behavior, which is just a Renius type, that the viscosity just increases like exponential 1 over t. However, you have a lot of materials in which something quite different happens, in which you have the behavior, which is certainly not, you see here an increase here, the increases become faster and faster, and this behavior is certainly far from being a simple Renius behavior. Now, of course, at that moment, therefore, there's two ideas. One idea that is that this is something that happens in this region here, and maybe at a later moment there will be an Arrhenius behavior. The other people that are trying to do argument that there is a real transition somewhere, and the viscosity will go into diverge in this way as a transition point. Of course, it's clear that we cannot decide these things by direct measurement, but of course, what we can try to understand better, what happens in this region here, and to see if one is doing some extra detail, one can construct a detailed theory which is going to explain the data in this region here, it's clear that this type of behavior will be more likely. And indeed, what happens, and this was the reason that I was trying to do these things into colors, that there is one region here where the behavior is more fitted by a power type divergence of the viscosity, and there is another region here where the things is more fitted like a Volker-Fulker behavior. So the phenomenology also may be not so simple. Now, another thing that is quite typical of glasses is what happens to the specific heat. No, you can the way the, you measure the, you can measure the specific heat, and just by cooling the system. And what happens is that the specific heat that you measure depend from the way you cool the system. If you you can cool the system in a very fast way, or you may cool the system in a very slow way. You don't have a 10 to the 18 order of magnitude of the way of cooling, because it's very difficult to cool the system more than 10 to the 3 degree per second. Apart from simulation, computer simulation, you can degree in a cool system. And the typical thing that happens is that the specific heat have a certain peak which remains finite. And the way that, however, more you cool, the system goes down, you cool slowly the system, more the peak of the specific heat moves at a lower temperature. Because people have a tendency to believe that when you go to lower temperature, you will take much more time to thermalize, and the peak of specific heat is related to the fact that the system has many states to explore, and if you cool very fast, you don't have enough time to explore all the possible amount of space. Now, which is the typical, now, when you start, however, you start to discuss this type of system, you would like to understand how it's done the phase space, and which is the free energy as function of configuration space, or the energy as function of configuration space. And of course, just because the configuration space and particle is n-dimensional, and we are discussing in infinite, in very large limit when the space becomes very large, what we can do two things. We only discuss about formula. And we have this will may be very clear, or you make just some cartoons and just say that the configuration space is one dimension. And the general idea that the cartoon that comes out from in trying to express in a graphic in a graphical way what comes out from formula, that the configuration space will start to have something like a flat region, like in SARD, in ordinary phase second order phase transition. However, when you go to some region or configuration space, you will have regions which are separated by very high barrier. And here the regions are written in a regular way. Here I make the same graph of these things here in the region down there, and it's showing that what one expects to have some valley which are very deep, they are distributed in some chaotic way. And if you have this type of phenomenology, you would expect that you have essentially two equilibration time. One equilibration time, which is the equilibration time in one barrier, and the other equilibration time, that is the time that is going on from one valley to another valley. And also, you have to understand that if the system at a certain moment is here, in order to arrive to the minimum that is there, you have to take it to go on to cross many barriers, and therefore this is going to explain the fact that the equilibration time is very large.